Hello, everyone. Welcome to the fourth panel of the Capitalist Mode of Power Past, Present, Future Conference. Tonight we have three speakers. One is Marc-Andre Gagnon from Carleton University. The other is D.T. Cochrane from York. And as a replacement for Eric George, who will be presenting tomorrow, we've got Jordan Brennan, also from York. Okay, Marc-Andre.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for having me here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to present about my PhD dissertation at York. It was using the theoretical framework of differential accumulation and applying it on the pharmaceutical sector, trying to see what can we get out of this theoretical framework to understand the pharmaceutical sector. So what I'm going to be discussing about first, political economy of big pharma. What are we talking about exactly? Quick reinterpretation of the concept of capital and power. Basically, I realize that everybody is now kind of very acquainted to these questions. And then trying to understand accumulation in the pharmaceutical sector through medical bias. When we're talking about the pharmaceutical sector, we're talking about big pharma. The vast majority of market shares, it was 17 companies. There's been some mergers and acquisitions. So 14 companies controlling at least 3/4 of market shares, full market share. And by the way, pharmaceuticals represent around 3% of the global production. So basically, we're not tackling global capitalism. We're just tackling 3% of global capitalism here. When we're discussing about big pharma, what I did here is just, there's always people saying, well, 14 companies, it's even more than car makers, for example, so it's still competition. What you have in terms of ongoing cooperation agreement, basically what I did is that for every ongoing cooperation agreement between two companies, I just drew a line. There's a lot of it, and this is normal, this is knowledge-based economy, it's based on patents, on licensing. Cooperation agreement also for marketing. This is kind of normal, but the idea here is that market competition is absolutely no regulation in the sector. At the contrary, it's some kind of huge cartel. Now, in terms of, this is the measurement I use for differential accumulation in the pharmaceutical sector. This is not the best, it's not a perfect measurement, but still it gives us an idea. The idea here is that I took the Fortune 500, so just the evolution of average real profits of pharmaceutical companies listed on Fortune 500 as compared to other companies from other industrial sectors. And basically, so we're comparing big pharma versus other dominant corporations in other sectors. This is the evolution of real profits. There's some issues about mergers and acquisitions maybe being more important because we're talking in terms of real profits. If we take rates of profits, so return on revenues here, we see the same trend. There's something happening in the 1980s. Something happens, basically you have this differential accumulation just in terms of the rate of profit. It's getting more and more profitable to be in the pharmaceutical sector. Now, you could say, well, in the 1980s, it's the rise of the knowledge-based economy, so this is normal, there's a lot of innovation, everything is going well, so that might explain why it's so profitable. Now, what's interesting with the pharmaceutical sector is that there is some way, some standards to measure what we call therapeutic innovation, so innovation in therapeutic terms instead of economic terms. And one of these standards is the introduction of new molecular entities. Basically, there's a huge diminution of the introduction of new molecular entities, which means totally new drugs that arrive on the market. Now, the thing is that regulations were very flexible, let's say, in the 1960s, as compared to what it is now. So you can say, well, maybe there's less drugs on the market now, but they are of better quality. So if there's a less important quantity, maybe it's better quality, so maybe there's still innovation that is important. Now, in terms of innovation, if you look at the qualitative dimension of therapeutic innovation in the sector. This is, a fantastic journal called Prescrire. This is an independent medical journal in France. What they do is that every year since 1981, they do a catalog of every new drug that were marketed in France. And they assess the drug in terms of their therapeutic advance as compared to the drugs that already exist. So the red section is the drugs that do not represent any significant therapeutic advance as compared to the drugs that are already on the market. The blue part is the drugs that do represent some significant therapeutic advance, while the section in green is the drugs that these independent doctor physicians consider that, well, these drugs should not be on the market because adverse effects are way more important than any benefits you could get with that. So just for an example, in 2009, 104 new drugs were introduced in France. Only 3 were considered and only a minor therapeutic advance. 95 did not bring anything new to the existing pharmacopoeia. And 19 of these 95 were harshly criticized by doctors since they represented potential danger to health. In fact, for the first time, Prescrire was talking in terms of, in 2009, you had a regression of the pharmacopoeia instead of an improvement during that year. So in terms of therapeutic innovation, it was negative. So just reinterpreting the concept of capital and power, I'll be maybe a little quick since you're all already familiar with that. The final conceit in economics about capital. We usually consider capital as means of production and as money at the same time, but the idea being, well, the value of the investment is the present value of anticipated future earning, but this investment takes the form of production goods that will produce social wealth, and when I sell the social wealth, well, it creates my earnings. And basically, this is, in a nutshell, the myth of the invisible hand by Adam Smith. By following its own interests, greater earnings, each individual will serve the public interest, the production of social wealth, in the best possible way. Now, what is kind of interesting with the new economy is, this is based on the economic report of the president in 2006, basically the physical assets, the value of physical assets in the American economy represented only 30% of the market value. So, what they're saying here is that, well, in fact, 70% of the market value must be intangible forms of productivity, so intangible assets. But they must be productive in some way. It has to be because, well, market value must be based somewhere on productivity, which is kind of a nonsense here. Contribution of Veblen by bringing the dichotomy between business and industry, between business income and industrial production, is to say, well, you know, there's just no direct determination between investment and production goods, between social wealth and earnings. And this is, I think, a great contribution to start thinking about investment and earnings only in terms of investment and earnings. Basically, you invest in anything that has an earning capacity, be it in terms of production goods, being in terms of anything else. So capital has capitalized institutional power. There's some ideas in that, implicit ideas in Veblen, but the works of Professor Bichler and Nitzan is fantastic on this. It's just, well, this is our point of departure, and let's start analyzing capitalism from this idea that capital is just capitalized institutional power. So from there, my interpretation of this is, capitalist control is mostly structural. It rests on social structures, institutions, and habits of thought. For example, Microsoft earning capacity rests more on the legitimacy of intellectual property rights in the mind of the public. If you stop believing in intellectual property and you consider that, well, I can download anything I want and I don't care about it, and everybody believes the same thing, basically Microsoft has a big problem there. The idea is that then you need to understand competition, capitalist competition in terms of structural competition. Competition by transforming and shaping institutional structures in a way that best serves dominant interests. So be it economic policies, protectionist regulations, rules of trade, the way you externalize cost, monopolistic power, national sentiment, labor condition can be just the way you organize the labor process as well. So competition becomes structural. This is not market competition, competition over prices. This is not monopolistic competition for differentiating products. This is structural competition, competing over institutional power by reshaping the social structure. Now, if we capitalize institutional power, what is this institutional power? How you define that? When analyzing the case of pharma, I think that Michel Foucault is kind of very interesting as a point of departure to try to define power. Reminder about Michel Foucault, power has no center, there's no sovereign power. Power is the multiplicity of relations, of force that are immanent to the dominant wherein they are exercised and that are constitutive of its organization. This idea that power is everywhere, not because it is a totalitarian structure, because it comes from everywhere. Language, for example, being one of the most important forms of power, knowledge, the way we classify things, disciplinary practices, biopower, etc., etc. So this idea that there's a microphysics of power, but in which it can be mobilized to create transverse divides in a number of local struggles to support greater structural domination. But Foucault considered that this microphysics of power, no individual will, no going concern was capable of developing or accumulating, capturing power inside this microphysics of power. It was just some kind of gravy that nobody was incapable of capturing. And I think that with Veblen, I think with just this idea that you have large corporations that are shaping the capitalist structure, we can start with the idea that, well, you have now new actors with corporate capitalism, corporation deploying strategy to acquire strategic elements in this microphysics of power in order to create transverse divides according to their interest. Now, how does it apply to the pharmaceutical sector? There's many elements. It's just we need to dive into this microphysics of power and the environment in which physicians are practicing, for example. Now, I won't go into the whole thing, but for example, with Joel Ekshin, we showed that drug companies were spending twice as much on promotion than on research and development, for example. And for example, in the United States, pharmaceutical industry was spending $61,000 per physician to influence their prescribing habits. So this is kind of huge. Now, the different strategies for marketing, for promotion, I won't go into that. It's just, for a long time, I was considering, you know, there's promotion versus research and development. And basically, promotion was kind of trying to influence in a bad way the physicians, while you have research and development, which is kind of something good. And, you know, in the end, this is absolutely a bad way to understand what is happening. When you get into research and development, well, research and development is organized as a promotional campaign, and that's it. For example, ghostwriting, basically the physicians signing studies that were made by the company, for example. When there's a clinical trial, most of the time the clinical trial is being run by contract research organizations. So this is, you have the large drug company hire a little contract research organization to run the trial. But financial incentive for the contract research organization is to provide the best results, the best data, to serve the interests of the company, because if you want to have another contract, well, basically, you need to get the good result. There's no falsification of data most of the time. Basically, it's just there's always room for maneuver, let's say, to produce the data in an angle that is kind of more interesting. Now, once these data are, you get the statistical data from contract research organization through the clinical trials. Now you ask medical writing agencies, to write papers. And for me, it was a fascinating world I was discovering, medical writing agencies. It's just when you're launching a new drug, what you want to have is that at the moment you start marketing the drug, you want to send your army of sales rep to see every doctor in the country, making sure that they will start prescribing the drug. In order to do that, you need scientific literature. And to have your scientific literature, you cannot rely on academic researchers, because academic researchers, well, you know, they are kind of lazy sometimes, they overloaded, they do not respect deadline, and you want to have your scientific literature produced at the right moment. So you ask medical writing agencies to do that. They write the papers, and then you ask physicians to sign their name on the study as if it was their own study. So when we're talking about ghostwriting, we're not normally talking about one study. But in fact, we should be talking in terms of ghost management of medical research. Because the clinical data are private. So basically, you publish only the data you want to be published. The one that are negative, you make sure that they do not get published. Then the type of publication plan you organize, you want to make sure that you have a scientific literature that will, when you get your drug approved, it's for a very specific use. You want to increase your market niche. To do that, you want the drug to be prescribed for what we call off-label use. So you produce a scientific literature pushing for off-label use. Neutralize negative messages, I'll get there, manage key opinion leaders, this is something a bit different. Just multiplication of positive studies. When I'm talking about publication plan, for Vioxx, for example, we all know Vioxx, 96 papers were produced by Merck's medical writing agencies. The key ones omitted mentioning the death of some patients during clinical trials. Merck also produced fake peer-reviewed journals that were published by this scientific publisher, Elsevier. Like Australasian Journal of Joint and Bone Medicine, so it was fake peer-reviewed journals, so you always send articles to physicians as if it was peer-reviewed. For Zoloft, 85 paper produced by Pfizer, out of a total of 211 papers in the literature at the time. The idea is, if you're an independent researcher, you produce a good research, independent research, showing some adverse effects for the drug. Well, the thing is that you don't have an army of sales rep who are going to go see every physician in the country pushing for your study. If you're part of the publication plan, well, for sure your article will have a much more important impact. Paxil, they call the ghostwriting campaign case study publication for peer review, so Casper, you know, so we know we're screwing medical research and we're having fun doing this, you know. Wyeth, Foreman, replacement therapy is another case. Corporate science in action, basically a publication plan. It involves normally around 60 people. So all the articles that come out of that, you have all expert statisticians. It's crispy articles. You don't need to review that almost when you send it to a peer-reviewed journal. Basically, it's clear it's going to be accepted because they're very clean, very crispy. And journals love these publications, basically. First, the company will buy a lot lots of handouts to distribute to doctors, so this is revenues for the companies. But medical publishers, what they want is to increase their impact factor. And what you want is studies that are going to be distributed by an army of sales rep. Now, if you produce... basically, medical knowledge, multiply positive studies, non-disclosure of negative studies, and what about those who are producing bad results for your drug? In the case of Merck, it was amazing because in Australia, there was a class action suit against Merck, so it's the only place where there was a trial. It was not an out-of-court settlement. So we managed to obtain access to internal data. That was amazing. So email saying about Well, Merck organized a list of rogue researchers that needed to be discredited or neutralized. So seek them out and destroy them where they live. Other cases, Nancy Olivieri with Apotex at the University of Toronto here. In the case of Avandia, GSK executive intimidated independent physicians. But just Merck, the list of rogue researchers, it was a list of 40 researchers. So, for example, James Macmillan discredited. So, point responsibilities, contact info, but then it continues. So, background, you explain what he does and everything. Visit from Leo and Bruce. So, we sent our team to meet with the guy, discuss with him, try to see how we could convince him to change his mind about our product. And basically, it seems that it didn't work, so discredit, a strong recommendation to discredit him. So it's not, you know, a zealot employee who disagrees with a research and takes the phone and starts saying bad things to the guy. No, it's organized. You manage medical knowledge. You have a team, you have a department working on this, and this is how you sell your product. Impacts on prescribing habits, just very quickly, basically we have totally irrational prescribing habits, just the case of antipsychotics for kids in Canada that tripled in the last 5 years. There's no clinical data showing that there's any benefit for kids or that there's no adverse effects for kids. So we're in a world where irrational prescribing habits are important. I would like just maybe to finish with that. Producing economic value in the pharmaceutical sector. It's not by innovating and by producing wealth, which is the traditional understanding of accumulation of value in capitalism. usually, we have to say, in economics, normally the company produce wealth. So through production, basically, this is a production of value. What we're saying here is that the company, what it produces, it's not drugs. It's medical knowledge. It's a social discourse. So, you know, in Marx, the idea is that there is the social, the system of social needs, the social determinants of value, or we discussed the value theory of labor, which I think would fit, in fact, in some ways in here. What we're saying is that, well, here you have huge corporations who manage to develop enough social power to directly produce the social determinants of value. So this is not just a problem of, well, you have production and then there's something fuzzy happening in the world of the distribution of the value that is produced. No, value is being produced by producing directly the social determinants of value. I think this is the best way to understand what is happening. So the shaping of knowledge and science has become the central focus of the creation of value. Science is becoming the battlefield for structural competition, and basically, this is not confined to medical research. I think pharmaceuticals is just a bit of a caricature of what is happening in many other sectors as well, tobacco, climate science, energy. In fact, any sector where risk management is important in a for-profit sector. Science is becoming a battlefield, and last point I wanted to raise is that this is, in fact, transformation of what is happening in terms of academic research. This is basically corporation investing universities in universities to produce this type of value. Now, we can only fight power with power, and the university has a strong tradition. It can be a strong countervailing power, and basically I sincerely hope that it will be organized this way. Thanks.
I've just left, good afternoon everyone. I've just left a couple of extra handouts up there. If anyone wants to get a hold of the slides, they're going to be up here, but if you wanted to get a closer look at them, they'll be down there. In recent years, we've heard a lot of talk about crisis and austerity. These two terms are saturating our political discourse. We seem to be living through a time of upheaval and even reckoning. Movements as seemingly disparate as the Occupy Wall Street movement and the Arab Spring, the strikes in Wisconsin, and the austerity resistance in Europe have a slight common thread running through them, and that's dissatisfaction with the status quo, whatever the status quo might be, and in some cases even a formal challenge to the power structure. What's interesting is that amidst all this turmoil, the word inequality has actually made its way into political discourse as well. The reasons why this is so are unclear to me, but if crises are the occasion for evaluating political programs, then we can't underestimate the significance of this word making its way into our public discussion, because it might signal a shift in the political mood. The dominant explanatory framework for income inequality in our society is that offered by mainstream economics. The question I have is, might radical institutionalism or the power approach to political economy have something important to offer to this conversation? And by the way, I think that the capitalist power label has to go. Something better has to be put in its place. In my presentation today, I'd like to claim that it does. What I'm going to do is contrast two sets of phenomena across two periods. I'm going to look at income inequality first and differential business performance second in Canada, across the neoliberal period, the neoliberal globalization of the last 30 years, and that contrasted to the Keynesian welfare state of the 30 years prior to that. And what I'm hoping to show you is an interesting set of relationships that might go some way to framing our discussion around crisis and inequality. So first, what exactly might a power approach have to say about inequality? Let's just take a slight detour first. Why does inequality matter? In 2009, two British epidemiologists published a book called The Spirit Level. Some are claiming that the contents of this book are the most important, the discoveries made in the book are the most important ever made by the social sciences. What these two authors suggest is the following, that societies that have more relative inequality or more relative poverty, a deeper structure in terms of its income, do worse in a whole range of social indicators, and this is independent of the average levels of wealth in the society. And I should have prefaced that with rich societies. We're talking about the OECD, so societies that are already very developed. So when they look across a whole range of very broad social indicators, things like childhood obesity, homicide, teenage pregnancy, mental illness, educational attainment, social mobility and social trust, a whole broad range of indicators, those societies do better if they're more equal, which is another way of saying there's a positive relationship between the Gini coefficient, which is a measure of income inequality in a society, and social pathology. Now, this undermines the view that social problems are created by poor material conditions. That's been, I think, the dominant way of thinking about social problems for I don't know how long. But if we could just get any people in our society up to a certain threshold, the social problems associated with being at the bottom of the social hierarchy will disappear. Their research shows that's not the case. What matters in society is how individuals relate to each other, not their absolute threshold of material comfort or affluence, which, by the way, to me sounds like a differential concept or something close to it. So reducing inequality is the best way of improving our social life, the quality of our social life, and the quality of our social environment. Now, what's happened to this singular measure in Canada over the last generation, and how are we to explain it? In figure one, I show you a disaggregated view of the top decile, the top 10% income share since 1982, and the top percentile, that's the richest 1% from 1920. This figure shows us two things of significance. The first is the top percentile income share. It takes a U-shape over the 20th century, so it falls dramatically during the Second World War, and then throughout the Golden Age, the so-called Golden Age, it continues to decline, albeit at a slower pace. It eventually stabilizes around 1980, and then begins to surge upwards in the late 1980s. Now, in Canada, it was thought until very recently that income inequality in Canadian society was being driven by gains made in the top quintile. That's the top 20%. And likely, the gains would be concentrated in the top decile. What this research shows is that income inequality in Canadian society, and indeed across the Anglo countries, is being driven by the top 1%, the top percentile. And incidentally, this data was made available by an economist named Michael Veal at McMaster University, who's been studying the subject for about 10 years. And I can only imagine how painstaking it would have been for him to have to extract this. Okay, now how does income inequality, how does the Gini coefficient stack up against the top percentile income share? The relationship between the two is remarkable. It's very, very tight. So inequality across Canadian society is being driven by the top percent, or in this case here I've showed you the top 0.1%. Now here are just a couple of relevant facts. How are we to explain them? I think that the popular explanation for this phenomenon is derived from a technical explanation. And the technical explanation comes from the 1890s, from the marginal productivity theory of distribution, most closely associated with Wicksteed, who published a book in 1894, and John Bates Clark's 1899 Distribution of Wealth. The skinny of this theory, I think everyone probably knows it, but just to state it for the sake of stating it, any variable factor of production or any unit of any factor will be remunerated at a rate proportional to its marginal contribution. So people in a competitive market get their due. People get the wealth that they themselves produce. So this theory doubles not only as a positive explanation for distributional reality, but as a normative principle of distributive justice. This is a double-sided theory. Whether or not Clark intended it as so, I don't know. Now, the popular explanation, of course, is derived from this. If you were to ask someone on the street, how do you explain income inequality? They'd say, well, the market reflects things like skill and talent and usefulness and effort and sheer luck. In the marketplace, people get their due. So long as we don't use force or fraud, distributional outcomes are just. Now, the question is, if distribution is ultimately to be explained by productivity or marginal productivity, how do we explain that? What determines how productive an individual is? Does anybody know? Economists typically will end the story there, but some people have tried to push the argument further. What determines how productive individual agents are? Does anyone have an idea? Okay. I didn't really have a clear idea myself. The answer, though, I think is going to make everyone in this room either uncomfortable or angry or both, and it's biologically based. In 1972, a Harvard psychologist named Richard Herrnstein published an article entitled IQ in the Atlantic Monthly. In that article, he argued that as society, he's talking about American society, as it became more egalitarian through the removal of arbitrary social barriers that discriminate on the basis of gender, ethnicity, culture, whatever, as those are pushed aside, the class structure and the distribution of income would no longer reflect social power, but would reflect mental ability. That is, ultimately, it would reflect IQ. His argument is each individual is a composite of their environmental factors and their hereditary factors. So if you push the environmental factors out of the way by making them equal, what's left is hereditary factors by mathematical necessity. So the class structure and distribution is ultimately explained through biology, because your intelligence, your IQ, is ultimately, for the most part, heritable. So in the causal explanation, and he was sort of, I think, ambiguous about this. Is this something to celebrate? It's a true meritocracy. This is an actual natural meritocracy. The class structure and inequality is explained by nature. So I don't know if this is a good thing or a bad thing. He was, I think, ambiguous about this. Chomsky was very quick to criticize this. In 1972, in the first journal issue of the journal Cognition, he laid bare the linkages this theory had to B.F. Skinner's behavioralism and state capitalist ideology. The article, I think, is really interesting and well-reasoned, and I'd advocate reading it, and I won't bother rehashing it to you. But what the neoclassical explanation has to do is the following. It explains, in this explanatory scheme, then, you move from the left to the right, or moving from that which explains to that which is to be explained involves moving from the individual material to the social relational. And so ultimately, if we want to explain inequality in our society, we have to look at the brain. That's ultimately where inequality is to be found, is in the mental capabilities of individuals. But even there, the problem doesn't really end. Let me backtrack for two seconds. I think for this explanation to be satisfactory, two things have to be demonstrated. First, quantitative correspondence between the work of highly intelligent people and the social usefulness of that work, their productivity. There has to be an establishment of quantitative correspondence there. And the second is, again, quantitative correspondence between the social usefulness of their work and their pecuniary earnings. And these as quantitative relationships. So this seems to me an impossible task. But even in this task, I think there is something that I've assumed, which I have neither demonstrated nor argued for. And this something is what the ancient Greeks called axia. This question is raised initially by Aristotle in Book 5 of his Ethics. It made its way into classical political economy through Marx, and more recently was surveyed by Cornelius Castoriadis. I'll skip over it because it's actually a complicated philosophical problem and not one I've completely wrapped my head around. But the purpose of me saying this is just simply to suggest to you that distribution, I think, is ultimately a political matter. Who gets what? And in accordance with what criterion are ultimately political questions. And this makes perfect sense, because if we remember the fact that political economy was initially conceived as a branch of moral philosophy, the questions of distribution which connect with justice fall into that domain. So distribution is a political question. And the conventional explanation seems to me to be inadequate on multiple levels. Now, let me give you another reason why we should doubt this. If you turn to figure 3, I plot the relationship between union density and the national wage bill in Canada. The wage bill is simply the share of national income going to wages and salaries, and union density is the percent of the workforce covered by some union. This figure shows us three relationships that are of some consequence. The first thing is that these two measures are tightly and positively correlated over time. So increasing union density corresponds with a higher national wage bill, i.e. redistribution. The second thing is that these two measures take an inverse U-shape over the post-war era. They rise throughout the 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s. They eventually level off and then decline since then. And note that this is the exact opposite of the top percentile income share. It took a U-shape. So this is the opposite here. And the third thing is that average annual inflation-adjusted wages rise when the wage bill, the national wage bill, goes up, and they stagnate or fall when the national wage bill falls. And I've embedded those figures in the chart. So in the 1950s, for instance, every year wages grew in inflation-adjusted terms by 3.3%, in the 1960s, 2.35%, and so on. So we've had stagnant wages for three decades, and this corresponds with deunionization. Now, I think that even though this is a simple quantitative relationship, underneath this quantitative relationship is a qualitative process of social struggle. This simple chart crystallizes and distills the manifestation of one of the most important social movements in Canadian history, and that's the labor movement. It captures the success and failures of this simple movement, and it involves a social struggle in the broadest sense. The process of unionization would have required community activism, large-scale social mobilization, and it goes all the way up to the highest levels of state policy, power, and even violence. So this simple chart captures, I think, quite a lot, and deunionization may itself be thought of as a power process. Now, what's another way in which social struggle manifests itself? In figure 4, I present the relationship between the top percentile income share and the broadest possible measure of social struggle I could conceive. I went to the national accounts and I extracted three pieces of information. Corporate profits, the second one is wages and salaries, and the third one is GDP. I divided the first two measures by the third to give us the share of national income going to capital in the form of profits, and then the share of national income going to labor in the form of wages. And then I divided the first by the second to give us a picture of distributional struggle between capital and labor. Now, it's certainly not a perfect relationship between these two measures, but it does show somewhat of a consistent story. Throughout the Golden Age, the so-called Golden Age, both measures fall, whereas the social struggle measure only actually rebounds after the NAFTA is signed in the early 1990s. Now, the capitalist power framework, however, encourages us not to think in aggregate or absolute terms, but in disaggregate and differential terms. So when I look at the corporate sector and I break it down to smaller units and look at differential outcomes, we get figure 5. This figure plots the relationship between differential capitalization and the top percentile income share. A differential capitalization is a ratio. It takes the top 60 firms on the Toronto Stock Exchange, the average, and divides it by the average of the entire stock exchange to compute a ratio. And this gives us the differential power of capital. And as you can see, the relationship is virtually perfect. This explains the differential capitalization, differential accumulation by dominant capital explains to a remarkable extent the top percentile income share. And so, income inequality across Canadian society because of what I showed you in figure 2. Now, is this relationship a fluke? Is it an anomalous coincidence? In figures 6 and 7, I show that it's not a fluke. It's rather systematic. And there's a trend there. In figure 6, I contrast the top percentile income share with differential net profit. Now, this figure is slightly different in the sense that I take the top 60 firms, their average net profit, and I divide it by the average net profit of the entire corporate sector, which includes listed and unlisted firms. And again, the relationship is remarkably positive. It's not quite as tight, but it's nearly as tight. In figure 7, I begin to decompose differential accumulation. Recall what Knitson and Bickler claim in Capitalist Power. They say that dominant capital can differentially accumulate using any one of three possible strategies: raising differential earnings, raising differential hype, or lowering differential risk. They claim that the first one is the most potent, raising differential earnings, and it has primacy over the long haul. Differential earnings per employee capture the elemental power per unit of organization, and so captures in an indirect form the differential power of capitalists. And what you see in this figure again is a remarkably tight correlation over a long period of time. Now the final measure, figure 8, shows us the relationship between social struggle, which is what I showed you in figure 4, and Michael Kaletsky's conception of the degree of monopoly. Knitson and Bickler use Kaletsky's conception as an economic proxy for the power of dominant capital. And this is registered in the profit markup, so the profit share of revenue of the top 60 firms in Canada. On the Toronto Stock Exchange. Now, Kaletsky thought that this measure, the degree of monopoly, had decisive importance for the relationship, the distributional struggle between capitalists and workers. And when you see that I plotted against the measure of capital and labor distributional struggle that I showed you in figure 4, it's remarkably tight. So Kaletsky's intuition seemed to be very accurate. Now, there are two things to note about the figure. The first is the obvious one, the tight and positive correlation over time. The second one is that even though both measures move cyclically, the overall trend is a U-shaped, which is the opposite, the inverse to union density and the wage bill. And again, there is some correlation between the top percentile income share. So in the way of a conclusion, just to wrap up, let me just restate the set of relationships I've tried to establish. The quality of our social environment and of our social relations depends on the degree of inequality in our society, which is another way of saying there's a positive relationship between the Gini coefficient and the top percentile and social pathology. Now, income gains made by the top percentile are driving changes in the Gini coefficient. That's figures 1 and 2, what I showed you. So how do we explain the top percentile income share? Well, figures 5, 6, and 7 show you that the differential accumulation by dominant capital is a pretty good entry point into trying to explain why the top percentile income share has surged. And don't forget, we're talking about social pathology. So when differential accumulation goes up, social pathology increases. Now, every other relevant measure of business performance, differential or not, including the capital-labor distributional struggle and the markup of dominant capital, take a U-shape over the 20th century, and this is mirrored inversely by union density and the wage bill. So in terms of contrasting the Golden Age and the Gilded Age, I think that radical institutionalism might have something interesting to say, at the very least empirically, if not more so. Thanks for your attention.
So quickly, I think that mainstream and Marxian economics can be thought of as having dual quantity theories. What does that mean? So they say that we have these observable financial quantities, and those are then a representation of real or hidden quantities. In the case of the Marxian economists, that hidden quantity is socially necessary abstract labor. In the case of the neoclassicists, it is utility. In this model of where financial quantities come from, the qualitative world has a very uncertain status. It does come into these analyses for the Marxians. The qualitative world has some role in determining what is socially necessary. However, as soon as you open up that debate, you start turning in circles and not really getting very far. And both view the qualitative world as playing some role in distorting this movement from the hidden quantities to observable financial quantities. Capital as power doesn't share in this dual quantity theory. For them, capital is finance and only finance. Financial quantities are the quantities we are concerned with. Where do those quantities come from? They are the outcome of social struggles and cooperation. So there's a qualitative aspect to this. So you have a qualitative world that is accounted for and translated into financial quantities. Those financial quantities then inform a pre-ordering of the qualitative world. And there's fuzziness on the qualitative world side because the movement from the qualitative to the financial is a very messy process, and the process of pre-ordering is also a very messy, uncertain process. So I told a friend that I was grappling with this issue of how these qualities are being translated into quantities, and she suggested I read a book edited by her then postdoc advisor, Andrew Berry, and his co-editor, Don Slater, called The Technological Economy. And the authors in the introduction identify actually three traditions, I only included two here, that are informing what some have referred to as the new economists. And Professor Jessup actually has a chapter in that book. So the first tradition that these new economic sociologists are drawing on is economic sociology. However, they have a problem with the concept of embeddedness that is a central focus of that economic sociology that says, well, we need to understand economies as embedded in the social world. And they say, well, that doesn't actually go far enough. The next source of inspiration is science and technology studies. And I think it's actually this inspiration that gives intersections with capital's power, which might seem unlikely given that science and technology studies has links to a tradition that Jonathan and Shimshon have derided as posty, but nonetheless, I think there are common desires in what they seek to understand. So first, I think both share a rejection of the micro-macro distinction. I think both believe that there is a constant construction of concrete entities with no structural context. So what the hell does that mean? So you're trying to understand labor struggles in the auto industry in the 1960s. You can simply say that, well, these labor struggles took place in a context of class struggle that exists throughout capitalist history and therefore explains that struggle. When, in fact, the reality is that at best, class struggle can be a shorthand way of referring to a social reality constructed at one moment by the struggles within the labor industry between auto workers and the auto businesses. And both stress the importance of measurement and calculation. And anyone who's had a chance to talk with Jonathan about what sort of research needs to be done knows how important he thinks quantitative work is. Well, at the same time, I don't think he's not a positivist in that believing that these quantities are somehow revealed truth. Instead, these quantities are, especially the quantities of capital, are a construction that those in power are using to understand their own power. And that idea of constructing, of calculation creating realities is also very much in the science and technology studies literature. And I think both demand a radical empiricism, that we have to be engaged with actually existing entities. And for Barry and Slater, they say that this radical empiricism we need because of the complexity of the world, that the world can't be simplified, the economic world can't be simplified with categories like labor and capital as found in neoclassical theory too readily, because it's a much more complex place than that. It's much more contingent, it's much more heterogeneous, it's much more local. So they say that complexity calls for ethnography. You need to be doing research at a very local level, doing what some refer to as tracing relations. You need to be picking an entity and then mapping out all of the relations that they have. However, they state that the focus on micro-level contingency does make it difficult to visualize the replication and transformation of structuring processes over time. And I think that the reason they fall into this perspective that there's no way to examine kind of structuring processes over time is they actually forget about the importance of calculation. And I think that complexity also calls for quantification. And I think that complexity calls for quantification both by those in power, because they're trying to understand their power over a complex world, and quantities make that a much simpler task, but it also calls for quantification by us. In the first place, it calls for us to examine the quantities of those in power. To me, it makes sense that if you want to understand power, you want to understand how power understands itself. And I think that Knitson and Bickler are correct in arguing that increasingly power understands itself in terms of the quantities reflected through capitalization. I think that capitalization serves as a universalizing process. It's not universal, and it's not tapping into some trans-historical universal truth. Instead, it's universalizing. So let's consider the complexity of General Electric. General Electric has 287,000 employees, at least it did in 2010, and that was after 17,000, a reduction of 17,000 people from its labor force. It operates in over 120 countries. It has $20 billion worth of machinery. It spent $39.3 million on lobbying. Now, already I think we're getting a picture of the complexity, and this is still a very simplified picture, in part because we're rendering all the qualitative complexity of GE into quantitative terms. All of those 287,000 employees are unique individuals contributing something to GE that get totally eliminated and rendered as 287,000 employees. So within that machinery, we have things like this, like the GE BCL300 centrifugal compressor, and if that's not complex, I don't know what is. We also have this, the GE building at 30 Rockefeller Plaza, I think it's called, the famous 30 Rock, which is not only GE headquarters, it's also an American cultural icon. This is also part of the complexity of GE. So in 120 countries around the world, you have GE operating. They have lobbyists, they have lawyers, they have all of their executives, and all of those executives have all of these other materials that comprise the complexity of GE, yet that gets universalized into this. This is 5 days of GE's market valuation. So yesterday at 1:40 p.m., all of that complexity got distilled into $16.70 a share. And not only does it render all of the complexity of GE into a readily understandable form, that then becomes comparable across every single corporation. So we could compare how GE is doing to the S&P 500. So you now have 500 of these behemoths who not only get distilled into their own share price, that all then gets combined into a single index number. So quantification serves to universalize, and that then allows us to visualize the replication and transformation of structuring processes over time. Now, the technological economy, one of its most inspiring thinkers was Michel Calon, who is one of the foundational thinkers of actor network theory. And the thinker even more associated with actor network theory is Bruno Latour, who might seem like an even more unlikely figure to have some common points with capital as power, since many consider him a postie without parallel. However, I think that that's based mostly on a misunderstanding of what Latour has tried to do and a misunderstanding of what he meant with one of his first books when he referred to social construction. So actor network theory rejects the idea that there can be a social explanation. You don't explain, say, a strike at GE by the social. In fact, the strike at GE is part of what comprises the social. The social is what we assemble. So this room is social because of us all gathering here together with all of the materials as well. This is the opposite of deconstruction. And Latour explicitly repudiates the tradition of deconstruction that has taken over French thought. He says we need to be much more concerned with what's being constructed. And an important part of that construction are the objects that forge these social ties. These relations among us take place through and including our object. So members of the social assemblage, Latour makes a distinction between intermediaries and mediators. So an intermediary is something that simply relays action initiated elsewhere, while a mediator makes a difference. Now, whether something is an intermediary or a mediator will depend on your perspective. So if you're flying in an airplane, you don't know what's going on inside the airplane. As long as the airplane gets you from where you left to where you're going, all of those parts are simply intermediaries relaying the action of the airplane as a whole. However, if one of those things goes wrong, and suddenly your plane is falling from the sky, whatever has gone wrong has now become a mediator to you. It's created a difference in the social assemblage in which you are participating. So, for Latour, an actor is something that makes a difference, and that means objects are also actors. So, a carpenter with a hammer, the hammer has to be considered an actor in that social assemblage of carpenter, hammer, nail. As far as the home purchaser is concerned, neither the hammer nor the carpenter are actors because all they're concerned with is the house that emerges at the end. So what ends up happening is all of the intermediaries, the things that are invisible to us, are put into what Latour refers to as black boxes. And I think that this has importance for capital as power because I think it refers to a black box is something that gets quantified, while what is inside is ignored. So market participants pricing GE concern themselves with a particular GE factory, say, but they don't concern themselves with the foreman who comes on for the graveyard shift, unless that foreman coming on for the graveyard shift falls asleep and causes an explosion at the factory that suddenly it needs to shut down. And I think the final point one additional point of intersection is the perspective of actor network theory on power. And so Latour says, power and domination have to be produced, made up, composed. Asymmetries exist, but where do they come from, and what are they made out of? And I think this connects with the struggles and cooperation that Knitson and Beekler identify as being the source of financial quantities. So capitalization is an account for power. Differential accumulation measures a redistribution of power. It's the perspective of the powerful, but it's not a a singular perspective on power, but I think it is ascendant. Knitson and Beekler have said that power can be understood as confidence in obedience. And so I think it's confidence in the obedience of all of one's assembled entities. And that includes the objects that are part of this assemblage. So I think that that means objects can also be disobedient. And I think that that disobedience opens up these black boxes. So this is the share price, the differential value of BP. So it's BP relative to the S&P 500. That's a thick black line. Both have been indexed. So then multiplied by 100. So when the thick black line is at 100, BP is just trailing with the S&P 500. Deepwater Horizon disaster occurs, and we can see that BP begins a deep descent. So this is just 3 months. So by the end of June, BP had lost 40% of its differential market value. What was the source? What caused that loss to occur? Well, suddenly, market participants were thinking about blowout preventers. How many of those market participants gave a shit about blowout preventers before one of them failed and caused the explosion on the Deepwater Horizon? And so they're doing all sorts of recalculations, trying to figure out what the impact on the future earnings of BP might be. And there's a lot of other things going on as well. But I think that that's what has happened. So this raises the question for me of what matters. And I realized after I made this title that it should have been what counts. So some of you are probably getting sick of seeing this graph. This is a graph that motivates my research. This is the wartime accumulation of De Beers compared to proxies for the US, UK, and South African markets. 19, I indexed them all for, sorry, I can't see the, okay, 1938 to 1940, pardon me. 1938 to 1940 equals 100. So what this shows is that between 1909 and 1940, De Beers had severe decumulation. The S&P 500, if you can find it, has the black diamonds, had slight accumulation until, of course, the 1930s, and then decumulation. De Beers reversed its differential fortunes in 1941. So it had had this long decline and then transformed its differential fortunes in the perspective of capitalist power. There's been a redistribution of power in its favor. So the question for me is why? Where did that come from? So one of the responses is industrial stones. So during World War II, the use of industrial stones skyrocketed. So this is the use of diamond, steel, and copper. All indexed to 1931 to 1940 equals 100. So compared to the decade prior, steel increased in use during the war about twice as much steel was being used. Copper, 2.5 times as much. Diamonds, almost 9 times as much. So one use for industrial diamond is drawing very fine wire. So you take a diamond, you put a very small hole in it, you then have a whole array of these diamonds, and then you pull a wire through it, making it smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller gauge. So this use, among many others, diamond is becoming a much more important industrial input. So that's one of the reasons. Gemstones are another reason. So De Beers started advertising during the 1940s for the first time, and that advertising then contributed to the diamond tradition when this influx of soldiers returning home caused a spike in marriages. So the marriage rate you see hits what is still a historical high, and jewelry as a share of GDP also hits a peak. And so the diamond tradition is created at this point. But at what scale do I need to take this analysis? So for example, this is an ad in The National Jeweler by N.W. Ayer, which was De Beers advertising agency. So they're advertising to Jewels. Here we have a magnificent new diamond window display. So they're saying you need to be concerned with how prospective consumers are viewing your diamonds. That's part of this social assemblage of creating this diamond tradition. So is that part of the tale that I need? Do I need to concern myself with window displays? For industrial stones, the makers of fine wire regularly inspected all of the dies. They had to measure the diameters of the dies because once they got too big, they had to be moved down the series and a new small one put in. They also had to examine to make sure no cracks were forming. So they were concerning themselves with individual diamonds. Individual diamonds were a matter of concern for these industrial users of diamonds. Does that also need to be part of my account? So I think only empirical research will answer that question of what counts. There are no a priori boundaries. However, I think quantitative maps can also give us signposts to where we need to investigate. And I think it also means there will necessarily be exclusions. I think those window displays, they are part of the accumulatory story of De Beers, but I'm not going to concern myself with them for many reasons, which also means there can never be a definitive explanation of what the accumulatory reasons are. Thank you.
Okay, we have 20 minutes for questions. Before we start, I'd just like to say that I didn't buy my now wife a diamond engagement ring because of Troy's research on De Beers. She hates him, but never mind. No, I was joking about that bit. Okay, questions?
Thank you. I've got two questions to offer. One was to Jonathan Brennan, looking at your first table and noting that you're looking at individual income survival and income tax data, excluding capital gains. So when I looked at your table, I wonder whether you explained anything at all, because at the bottom of your trough is when capital gains taxes were introduced. And the change might be accounted for by simple tax planning strategies. And that sort of thing is incorporated into your analysis of the way you deal with it. Say some of that, and be old enough to have actually been there when capital gains tax was introduced. And during all the debates at the time about how people were avoiding taxes by making their incomes into capital gains. And similarly, I had a question for Marc-Andre Gagnon, in which your measures are ones of profit rates and these types of things. And I was reflecting on Professor Nitzan's presentation last year, where we talked about the using share price because it incorporated risk, and that collectively the market assesses risks based on share price. And I'm wondering if you looked at things like your innovation measures and your marketing measures and against share price, and whether, in fact, the share prices, do they incorporate the investors' assumptions about risk and consequently the punishment reward for the people running the companies and doing these fraudulent things that you described.
Jonathan, Just a very, very quick question for Jordan. What do you have against the term capitalist power?
Okay, Marc-Andre, would you like to start?
The inclusion of the question of risk, yes, risk is an important factor in the determination of price. In that specific case, it's just you look year after year, revenues of the drug companies, there's little volatility, in fact. And the question of risk is just, there's all discourse about how costly it is to produce a new drug, 800 million, now it's 1.4 billion, and some estimates 2.6 billion to produce a new drug. But if you look in terms of net profits year after year, there's not a large volatility. The question of risk is not really important, because in fact what you see is the importance of mergers and acquisitions. As soon as there are some problems in terms of, well, at the end of the year we will not get into what we need in terms of production or what not of production, in terms of bringing a new drug on the market, basically let's buy this other company that has some drugs and we'll bring it on the market. So basically, in the end, when you try to assess the risk of these companies, not for the large company, I mean, risk is important for smarter biotech companies, that's for sure. But smarter biotechs are not part of this picture. This is not part of Big Pharma. And Big Pharma, the question of risk is, I think, is not an important factor in the determination of their profits here.
John?
So with respect to the income tax question, the incomes are pre-tax, so this is simply market income excluding capital gains, and that's just what I wanted to show, is the distribution. This isn't my data, I should say. This is the data of a very devoted economist who must have spent a lot of time on this. I don't know the history of the capital gains taxes in Canada. To Joe, Capitalist Power is the name of a book, so I don't know of any book named Neoclassical Economics or Keynesianism or something else. I just suggest that the title could be outside the title of the book and still describe the framework which the book is trying to invent. So I'm just simply saying I think capitalist power is not, if we're going to talk about brand and brand recognition, which I know is maybe not popular, it's not going to win hearts and minds.
Okay, and we have a question at the front. Is there any other questions?
I'm really not sure. I'm really not sure. I got the. Let's frame it another way. In Mr. Cochrane, in your presentation, you told us at some point that the importance of looking into the quantitative data was the way they are used by the power to account for themselves, or something that was similar to that. If we put so much emphasis on the quantities as being part of a discourse, in a constructed discourse that accounts for and explains or power as such, but within a discourse, what is the difference between a quantity and a quality? This is my simple question. Thank you.
I think Jonathan has one at the back. Sorry.
Yes, my question is for Troy. You leverage this idea that objects can obey or not obey, and how important that might be was illustrated with the deep waters disaster, etc. But I'm just wondering how really important are these objects, because if this bursting of the well were to occur under conditions in which no penalty would be levied on British Petroleum, would this have any impact on its stock prices whatsoever? So behind this breakdown of the physical equipment, there's a social reality that makes that breakdown costly. If that social reality was different, the cost was different, then the response would have been different. So sure, the material is important, the physical apparatus is important, but unless it's mediated with some social reality, we can't really understand how important it is. It's like a question that was raised to me, last year, about why do I consider, say, climate change or peak oil as being important from a social perspective? And I said, of course it is important because capital assesses these natural processes only from a social perspective. So that's the question to you to think about the thing.
I have a quick comment to Jordan and a comment for Marc-Andre. For Jordan, you were talking about biological determinism. There's a really good book. It's a succinct summary by Lewontin, Ideology. Biology is Ideology. I assign it in my intro class. He does a really good job of detailing or refuting that argument regarding the IQ and genes. For one, there is a positive correlation, but the level is not the same as the identity. So there's a weak correlation there, but the model that they present anyway is just a triple helix model where you have gene, organism, and environment. So check that out. I think that's a pretty good review of that. Marc-Andre, I really liked your presentation. I thought it was awesome. I think I'm wondering, one of the things that I read recently was that through the Freedom of Information Act, and forgive me if you cited this particular study, what they find with antidepressants, for example, is that most 98%, the author of a book called The Emperor's New Drugs just came out. The Emperor's New Drugs. He acquired some information through the Freedom of Information Act. And as you know, most of the studies that are published, not all of the studies that are conducted are published. So a lot of those end up with the DEA, the FDA. And a lot of those are not accessible to the public and by doctors. And this particular researcher actually got a lot of the other studies. And once you take into account the studies that didn't really show any results, it's basically on par with placebo. Plus in France, there's a new drug out. It's an SSRE as opposed to an SSRI, which chemically does the exact opposite. And it's getting the same results. More controversially, have you ever checked out some of the claims that are made about AZT and things like that by people like Duesberg in Berkeley and people like that? It was an old chemotherapy treatment. It's some people regard it as not particularly effective.
Okay, Troy.
To the first question, I think quantities are important for the reason that I outlined in their universalizing process, the fact that they do allow us to smooth over the complexity. They should never be taken as some kind of truthful representation, but are instead a creative means of making sense of the social world, not least because those in power make use of those means as well. And so, the stock market is operating every day for power to continually assess what is happening in the world.
Do you allow me to specify my question?
Sure.
My question is not if they matter, is what is the difference between a quantity and a quality?
I'm not sure I know what you're getting at.
It's the basic question, because we have the differentiation in your presentation between a quality and a quantity. And I see the quantity is taking a specific space within the side from quality. And I'm asking you, in this such a context, what is the difference between a quality and a quantity?
Well, I mean, they have a relationship, but I think there's also, going and wandering around an oil rig in the Gulf of Mexico and experiencing it qualitatively isn't the same as seeing it on BP's balance sheet valued at, I don't know what an oil well is worth, $500 million or whatever. Like, there's obviously a difference between those. For the workers on the oil rig, it's a huge difference. You know, the quality of life on that oil rig matters to them. It matters much less what that's recorded at on BP's balance sheet. So again, it's a matter of whose perspective it is. And Jonathan, I think you're right, except for the claim that there's this social reality behind this object. This social reality is bound up with this object. If I could show another graph quickly.
I thought it would be interesting to compare what happened differentially to Exxon after the Exxon Valdez disaster. And we can see that not only, so this is the volume of share trading are the bar graphs. And Exxon in the first 3 months only lost 10% of value following its disaster. And so there is definitely a different social reality to what happened, but that includes the objects themselves. The objects can't be removed from this account. So the fact that it was one blowout preventer that failed, but there are also however many other rigs that also have these blowout preventers that could also fail, now need to be replaced, new safety regulations, is different than the fact that you have a single ship, it was tabulated up to Captain Air. This is all part of that story, and what I'm saying is that we don't have recourse to sort of social explanations that exclude the objects from the explanation.
John?
Yes?
Did you want to respond?
I think there was just a comment directed to me at the beginning.
Well, yes, antidepressants, different things. Some of the large categories of prescription drugs, so antidepressants, antipsychotics, or antihypertensive drugs, for example, or even statins. Antihypertensive drugs, there was a huge study in 2002, the ALAT study, so a huge public clinical trial comparing the new generation of antihypertensive drugs, I think it was beta blockers, as compared to the older generation, the 60s, diuretics. And what the study showed basically is that, well, the older generation of antihypertensive drug that was costing 10 times less was in fact more, well, it's efficacious, was more efficient in cost term, more efficacious in clinical terms. Same case for antipsychotics, for example. There was a study by Jones in 2006 showing that the new generation of atypical antipsychotics were, in fact, no more benefits than the older generation, but, in fact, more adverse effects. And then last week, there's a fantastic study in the British Journal of Psychiatry. Huge clinical trials in China, a longitudinal study over 9 years. So take a cohort. One cohort, they gave them the new generation of antipsychotics, the other part of the cohort, the old generation of antipsychotics. And basically, it's exactly the same. The difference is the first one were produced in the 1960s, and they cost nothing on the market versus Seroquel, $300 a month for something that gives you 20 pounds in a couple of days when you take that. For antidepressants, I think this is the next category that is gonna bite the dust, let's say. The number is, in fact, 70% of people taking SSRI, in fact, the drug has no better effect than a placebo. And it was, yes, Irving Kirsch and that, but also the studies by Fournier. But I saw a fantastic debate between Irving Kirsch and this other guy, mostly paid by the drug industry. And the guy was saying, well, you know, you're right that most antidepressants do not have better effect than a placebo. But the problem is the increase of the placebo effect in clinical trials. It's just with contract research organization everywhere,
Because there's little effect to measure in terms of therapeutic effect, what you need to do is to run larger clinical trials. So you need to enroll more patients, and there's a lack of patients, and basically we take patients of less quality, which artificially increase the placebo effect. So in the end, it's not the fault of the antidepressant, which is better than a placebo, but it's the fault of faulty clinical trials that are being organized. But, you know, it's just, well, in terms of science, I don't care what's the reason. If you cannot prove in terms of clinical data that your medication is better than a placebo, there's no reason for the medication to get on the market. This is absolutely nonsense. But on AZT, this is not one of the cases I study, I must say.
And we have time for a final question. The gentleman in the second row.
My question is for Marc-Andre. I enjoyed all of those papers, but I was a little bit, disappointed that you were so readily dismissive of Foucault's application in your work. I feel that he had, certainly the development of his work by Lemke and Nicholas Rose has quite a bit to say about the operation of power as technology in the context of neoliberalism. And I suspect that his work, Foucault's work, could be very useful in elaborating the notion of capitalization in capitalist power, in elaborating that insofar as it helps us to understand the operation of power and its impact on the body and the operation of the mind. All of those areas need further investigation, I would have thought, and Foucault's work shouldn't be so readily dismissed in that context, I would have thought.
Brief. Very briefly, I was not discarding Foucault, at the contrary, I was saying I think Foucault is the most interesting way to try to understand how power works, basically. And from there, it's just the problem I have with Foucault is that for him, there's no possibility for a specific actor to accumulate or capture power. It's just power is kind of too difficult to grasp. It's too complex. But it's just with the rise of huge corporations, for me, it's just, well, in this microphysics of power, you have these huge going concerns who develop this expertise in order to try to capture and accumulate the parts of this microphysics of power. I mean, basically, it's amazing how drug companies manage to emissate? get into all the parts of the environment of the physician and making sure that you control everything, all the information he gets, organize the way he meets with patients, how you build the medical knowledge, and how you in fact control every part of the environment of the physician, which is the demand side. You have supply and demand, and this is a fantastic demand side. It's a demand without a budget constraint. This is just amazing in the pharmaceutical sector. So you control just everything in the environment of the physician to make sure that he will do the action as you wish him to do.